y'all are not moshing with me enough. The point of this is to mosh. Like, ask me a question. Say, no, you're wrong about that. Mosh.
Well, I don't.
Doc, what have you been playing?
I don't disagree with you, bro.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Chris, and Doc discuss lore in video games and how it is best used to inform and immerse the player. Plus, we debut a series of new segments to open the show. Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward-Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode 30 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. This is our the first week of our reboot, essentially. We've got a new site, we've got a new style. We're going to be taking things in a bit of a different direction now. But I am Chris, and I'm joined by Jim.
Hello.
And I'm joined by Doc.
Hey, hey, can I be Enzo?
No.
Anybody going to get that joke?
I didn't.
Oh, I didn't get it either.
That's totally fine. Somebody out there got it, and I appreciate you.
We've got a bit of a different format now on the podcast. We're going to be doing a number of segments to open up our shows now. These are interchangeable, so we'll be, whenever someone has a topic they want to talk about that fits one of our segments, we'll bring that in, talk about it for a bit, do another segment or two, and then we'll dive into our main discussion of the day, which a preview for you guys. What is our main discussion for the day? I'm totally forgetting all of a sudden.
We're going to be talking about lore in games and the use of lore in terms of filling out the narrative and how it's presented in games.
Oh, awesome. I thought we were talking about the character from Star Trek.
No. If you researched lore from Star Trek, you've done the wrong thing.
Oh. Well, not lore from Star Trek, but lore from Star Trek. Data's brother?
That's what I said.
Right.
That's not what I said?
No, I don't think you spelled it that way when you said it.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. You're probably right. I always have that problem.
Is it not spelled L-O-R-E?
No, actually, it's L-O-R.
Ah, yeah, he's right. I mispronounced it.
It's pronounced data, not data, as well. And I think that's an important thing.
That one I got right.
Yeah, you did.
Now, shouldn't he be called datum as a singular?
No.
No.
The plural of data is data.
I know.
Also,
if he is a single datum as a entity.
Ooh.
Unless he is just a collection of data, and therefore
he is a collection of data.
He's got 36, I want to say, personalities integrated into his own from the colonists of the original.
But aren't we all a collection of data?
No,
no,
no.
Okay,
we are a series of tubes.
Yeah, because that's dangerously close to talking about my parents, and that would be weird.
So I guess we'll go in and jump into appropriately. We will jump into our first segment, which we're calling Button Mosh.
For the Button Mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
So recently, this past weekend, I did pick up a PS4. So I've been playing a lot of The Witcher 3, which is actually a very fun game. I'm sure it will come up during the lore discussion. In fact, I plan for it too. Have y'all played any of The Witcher games before?
All of 10 minutes of the first one.
10 minutes of the first one. Did you think it was too hard?
Basically, I got started with combat and couldn't quite figure it. Like, I have this problem sometimes when I'm playing games where I really want to get into a game, but then for some reason when I actually get to the gameplay, I'm just kind of like, I don't feel like doing this right now, and I quit. That's what happened with The Witcher. So I'm sure it's a great game, I just haven't really played it.
I think so. The Witcher 1 in particular is pretty rough, and Witcher 2 improves a lot, but I think Witcher 3 has the most streamlined gameplay of the series, so I think it's definitely the one to jump into if you haven't experienced the series yet. What I think is the most interesting about it, it is a hard game, but they do let you choose your difficulty level. In fact, you might want to, if you're not used to it, pick the lowest, which is, I think it's called Story Only. They actually name it after what you want from the game.
Interesting.
So, the first difficulty is Story Only. Mm-hmm. The next one is, oh, geez, I want to call it something like Blood and Glory or something like that. I'm playing on that one, the second one, where it's more difficult. You still kind of have to have know how to play the game, but there's a lot more focus on the story. And then the one right after that is even harder. Mm-hmm. And there's like a final mode where it's something related to you essentially just want the game to punish you. And it's all focused on you have to be extremely good. You have to go out and make sure that you level up properly. Mm-hmm. And but yeah, this is an action role-playing game, with a deep narrative, because of course it comes from a
series of books.
Scandinavian,
Polish.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you. Polish series,
mm-hmm.
which of course I have not read because I do not speak Polish.
Mm-hmm. Is it available in English? Has anyone translated it?
That's a good question. My guess would be probably, just because the game series has gotten better and better, that there's probably at least a fan translation out there, but in terms of an official translation, I don't know.
I just run it through Google, it'll be fine.
There's a lot of really cool story to it, and by story I just mean sort of the world itself, world building. But yeah, I don't want to monopolize the talk too much.
Oh yeah, no.
And y'all are not moshing with me enough. The point of this is to mosh. Like, ask me a question. Say no, you're wrong about that. Mosh.
Well, I don't.
Doc, what have you been playing?
I don't disagree with you, bro.
Well, yeah. I guess the problem is that, except for maybe like a Let's Play on Witcher 2, I'm a Witcher virgin. So.
Right. Well, I just mean in general, what have you been playing?
Well, actually, the other day, I'll preface this by a minor complaint, which is that I gathered up about half of my video game collection and took it in thinking, all right, I'm going to have enough to buy a new system or 30 games or something like that. And I walked out of the store, which will sort of remain nameless, with $50 in trade after a huge stack.
Never sell your games to that
particular the one that location.
Shall not, the store that shall not be named.
Yeah,
they're so, local, actually. Their headquarters is local.
Are they?
Yeah.
Well, I didn't realize that. That's interesting.
Yeah, I would. You'd much better off if you're planning to do that.
So
put it on eBay.
The next time I think,
we just totally gave away who it is.
The next time I think of, it was hard to guess, you know, selling my games, I'm going to just stop.
Yeah.
And not do that. So
I would. Yeah, the last time I did that, I had. I didn't really regret it because I was able to walk out with two new games, which was cool. That's actually how I got Mass Effect 2, because I didn't realize it had been ported to PS3 at the time. So I'm like, oh, they have it on PS3. I'm totally going to get it. And that's how I got into Mass Effect. But yeah, it was funny because I went in there and I didn't regret it for most of them, but there were a couple where I looked at my receipt and I got all of like a dollar for some of them.
What does it show on the receipt?
Yeah, it actually does.
Oh, I need to get
it's absurd. Mm-hmm. And I
will say the anger all over.
Yeah. Yeah. But when I looked at the receipt, it's like, okay, so that one I would have kept for the dollar, you know?
Yeah.
But this one for the $5 I got from it, okay, cool. You know, it added up.
Yeah, so I got home and I was all excited, you know, because I just let the emotion of that just slide right past me, because I had $50 worth of PlayStation Network credit at that point, which is what I immediately converted it into. Mm. And so I was excited. I was going to download a bunch of games. I did a thing. So the first thing I hit was Broken Age. And I'm like, cool, I'm finally going to play Broken Age. And I don't know. I was just terribly disappointed. I was just absolutely, completely underwhelmed by the Tim Schafer-ness that is that.
There was... I played a demo of it. It must have been a demo. How did I play that game? I think it must have been a demo. But out of that, or I played it at some friend's place, because I don't remember actually getting the game and playing it all the way through.
Yeah.
But I played some of it and had the same sort of experience.
If I had spent $5 on it, or maybe even $10, I would have been fine.
Yeah.
But the fact that I paid pretty much like full price for it and then was just literally insulted as a gamer for the first 10, 15 minutes and treated like... Well, I mean, it's the most babyish game, and I get what they were going for. I get it. It's irony, but it was the most babyish experience that I've. And I love adventure games. I love Monkey Island. I love all that kind of a thing. So I don't know. That was deeply disappointing to me. That's my story. Is that I traded in my stack of games, and it converted into a game that I probably won't even finish.
It's time for War Stories, tales of tribulation and triumph in gaming.
I've got a war story to tell, a gaming war story. As I said before, I did get a PS4 this weekend, but I didn't have the usual, I don't know if this is even unusual, but I didn't have the experience, normal PS4 or console buying experience, that I expected to have. I expected to go into Fry's. Should I say the name of the store? I'm going to say the name of the store, because I'm pissed at Fry's and I'm never going to shop there again. And I'm going to tell you why. So this is not considered a slander, because this is all factual information. So I go into Fry's thinking, because it's literally across the street from my apartment. So I think, oh, I'll just walk in there. I'll get a PS4 today, because I felt like I had the money saved up and I've been working. I felt I'm going to buy myself a new system. So I go in, because it's my first next generation or current generation, whatever we're calling it. So I go in to purchase the PS4. First of all, I can't find him in the store, because apparently they keep them in some, like, special cage somewhere. So I'm in the section for the consoles looking around, thinking they don't even sell consoles, until I find one of the workers there. And I won't say his name. But he goes off and takes a very long time finding my console in, like, the back cage. Finally comes out, and the box is scuffed up and a little you know, I don't want to say messy, but, like, there are some tears in the box. And I'm thinking, oh, maybe it was, like, just stacked on top of something.
Handled roughly.
But it shouldn't be a problem, right? I mean, this is a you know, multi-million dollar corporation. Of course they can't get it wrong selling me a frickin' console that was in a box sent from...
And that's what boxes are for, after all, is to protect what's inside.
Exactly. So I wasn't really too worried. So after having him babysit me with the console up to the front, because, of course, if he had just handed it to me and let me wait in line by myself... Clearly, I would have just turned tail and run right out the store. He knew this. I mean, he could tell that I'm the sort of person that would do this.
To be fair, he wanted his commission.
I guess. I don't even know if it's a commission. He didn't do anything except
get
out of a
commission
cage.
At Fry's?
Yes.
Yes, they absolutely do.
Really?
Huh.
Yeah. I know this because I went back when I owned the school. I used to go in and say, I would like 12 computers, please. And they would fall all over themselves to serve me. Because that wow. made their month.
I should have told him I wanted 12 PS4s. He would run back, get 12, and then I'd say, just one. And then I'd take the one up, and then...
That's the least scuffed, yeah.
Yeah, the least scuffed. So, the one that looks like it hasn't been handled before, we'll say. Okay, so finally, I waited in line with him, which you would think he'd take me straight to the front, but no. So, I finally... That was kind of an awkward situation, too. He's just kind of standing there silently, stoically, like some sort of a British Bobby or whatever the hell those things are. That's the policeman, right? Anyway,
yes. Yes.
So I go up to the front. I was thinking of the guards, I think. So I go, Buckingham Palace guards, I guess. So I go, you know, I pay for my system, and of course, there's the hidden charge of tax, too. So you think you're paying $400. You're like, it's $400. Then you're like, but then there's tax. It's like $50 tax or something.
Yeah.
So, but I'm like, okay, cool. I'm excited. I got my system. I got my game, Witcher 3, ready to go. I take it home, take it out of the box. Second I open the box, I'm already kind of disappointed because the plastic is already off of the console.
Huh.
So I'm thinking, what happened here? Maybe they took it off because there's some sort of a Fry's policy that they have to check it to make sure it's okay, right? Maybe they do some sort of a test. It's like quality assurance, you know? That sounds like it could be useful. I'm, of course, talking myself into this because this is idiotic.
I like your optimism,
too.
Right?
So I take it out and I set it up. And I'm noticing more and more parts are already taken apart, so I'm already a little bit worried. But I set it up anyway, and I plug it in, and there's this download section and all that. And the second I put it in, there's already a user. Like, it's just straight up already has a user. And I'm not going to say his name, but I will say that it clearly wasn't, like, it was clearly someone's actual, like, it wasn't some sort of, like, special, it was a clear name, it was an actual person with their own avatar and everything. So... I actually go ahead and go through the process of creating a new user, because at first I'm thinking, again, optimistically, maybe someone had tested this out at the factory, or so. This is like a special PlayStation thing where, like, instead of calling it PS user, some sort of an in-joke, and I just don't get it. I'm trying to convince myself that it's okay to keep this. So I get in, and I find out things, for example, that the PS4 systems now, they all sell with a free code for The Last of Us. Which I still haven't played, by the way. So I have that game, too, apparently. It's a download code. So I come in, and I find out by entering the download code it doesn't work, because someone, of course, has already claimed it, which was the other person who had the system before me. I find that there are various things downloaded, but none of them work anymore, because they're tied to a different PSN account, obviously. I go in, I'm looking at the different video options, and I find out that I can access this person's Netflix account. I mean, it's actually set up, even though I'm a different user. I can access his Netflix account. Not that I care, because I have my own. So now I'm sitting here going, this is crap. So I have to return it to the store, of course, because I'm not going to keep this. Because I started looking at the dates, and apparently he had only had his system for about 2 weeks before returning it. And played Destiny, and I guess Last of Us, and then that was it. So I'm thinking, like, what happened to the system that he had to return it in 2 weeks? No one buys a console and returns it in 2 weeks.
Maybe he just didn't think he bought the PS4 for The Last of Us and Destiny and didn't like those. And so, you know what? I don't need the console anymore.
His girlfriend said, you did what?
Possibly. It could be something like that. I don't know. But I wasn't going to take the risk, of course, because you never know. It could be a hardware issue. And then, of course, I'm screwed. So I take it back, and I'm thinking, of course, I'm very annoyed that I have to take it back, because I have to unbox everything, put it all back in the box, try to get everything to fit. Of course, it doesn't fit, because it never fits back in the box perfectly. So I have this whole thing where I can barely fit the box together, trying to bring it back in the store. And now I have to wait in the customer service line for an hour. First of all, I have to wait through the line. Then when I get up to the front, there's only one person working there. And she did a good job, by the way. But she was the only person working there, way overworked. And I had... You know, while she's waiting, she couldn't find anyone to unlock the cage because they didn't give her a key to the cage. She couldn't even get in there to get me a new system. I'm trying to explain to them what happened. Mm. I mean, they actually were very upfront about letting me, you know, do this without really checking the system anyway. So I'm assuming this has happened many times before.
Mm-hmm.
But essentially, they sold me a used system that they did not put in the refurbished box, and I had to go back and get a new one. And this time, she actually opened it in front of me and showed me that it was to make sure. Mm-hmm. Everything's sealed. Everything's in there. Works fine. I mean, I am satisfied with my purchase. I'm a little annoyed that every time I get a game, it has to sit there and download for a while before it starts. It
installs, yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
That is the current generation, I guess, of games.
Blame Sony for that one.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I don't know if the Xbox One does the same thing. I have no idea.
Actually, it does, yeah.
I would guess so, yeah. But, I guess it's just the current generation that we live in.
What you need to be doing is pre-ordering these things and then downloading them
in advance. Yeah.
And then you'll be fine. See, that's...
Which gives me another... This is not really... I guess this is sort of a war story, but also...
That was my cynical face, by the way.
I went ahead and I also got NBA 2K15 because I was interested to try that out. I know partially because you had played it and I liked the My Career System concept.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've been following basketball again... somewhat recently, yeah. So I thought I'll go
I've been
ahead
renting
and,
15, yeah.
Right, so I went ahead and I ordered online. It was cheaper online. And I finally got it yesterday, so I put that in to play it. And I'm freaking out because you start the game, and I've downloaded everything before I even started it. And the first thing you do is you have to play a game between the Spurs and the Heat. You have to.
Do you?
Yes. It is apparent. Maybe it's a new update. I don't know. Maybe you didn't have to go through it, but I had to play through the entire game before it would let me actually start... You know, the game and go through the options and select who I wanted to play as and do any. You literally can't do anything in the game except, like, I tried closing it and coming back in. I tried everything. I also made sure and went into my download list because apparently, you know, THQ.
You couldn't, like, hit, I guess they call it options now, but the options button and quit and go to the main menu?
You can. If you go to the hit the options button, go to quit, you go to the main menu and nothing happens. You're just on the main menu and then you can go into the game again. It forces you to play through the game.
That's very odd.
Yes.
Because I didn't have that.
Well, but so you might have played initially on an earlier version before they had some sort of an update. Because I was looking online for it, and apparently lots of people had the same issue.
Huh.
It drove me nuts, because I actually thought it was broken in some way, that somehow the game wasn't going to work. Because they were kept saying, oh yeah, it's just downloaded in the background, and I go into my PS options, and
you know what?
I did
have that while it was downloading, but when it was done downloading, I had no problem.
But for me, I went in and I checked, and it said no active downloads, and it's perfect. So that's why it was driving me nuts.
Yeah.
But I finally got through. I got through that. Once I did, it's cool. I like the My Career. I do think it's absurd that they only give you two voice options.
The writing's terrible too.
Yeah,
it used to just be one voice, so I guess having another voice is cool, but it doesn't sound that different.
No, yeah, the two voices are almost identical. So I'm thinking it doesn't fit. Neither of these are like me at all, but it's not so much that they're not like me, it's just that they're not different enough to even warrant having two voices.
Like urban, like grew up in the inner city sort of voice.
Both of them.
And one is just deeper. The deeper one is the old one, and the new one is just like kind of a higher, tenier, maybe a little bit more cocky voice.
A little more country.
Maybe slightly,
there is definitely a little country,
but
to it.
They're both.
But you're right. They're both like, more like inner city.
Yeah, neither of them is like neutral American.
So you
accent.
Get to pick between Flava Flav and Vanilla Ice, basically.
Maybe.
Okay.
I don't know. That's a decent comparison.
Okay. But yeah, it's. So that's kind of jarring whenever I talk, but I actually am kind of enjoying the story and the way that it goes through.
Yeah,
I like those in sports games, admittedly.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's a lot of options, so it's a pretty cool game. I haven't really explored it fully, but I guess those are my two sort of, you know, war story experiences in gaming.
Well, there you go, war stories.
Woohoo!
Now it's time for Table Talk, discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
So I guess the big news on Backward-Compatible.com front is that we have just completed in the can our first of our own RPG series, which we're calling Roll With It. And so I'm excited that that's going to be coming up very, very soon. Actually, I guess the first episode will already be out by the time...
It'll be coming out... When you're listening to this, it'll be coming out this Friday.
Yeah. It might be kind of fun if we did, like, a... I don't know, a teaser or something.
I would love to have a teaser.
I could put a teaser.
Yeah, almost a trailer. Awesome. Mm-hmm. That'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, like a minute and a half.
So, here's a little teaser for that, then.
Yeah.
You awake in a dimly lit room.
In a dystopian future where the transfer of human consciousness is commonplace.
I don't remember how we got here. I don't remember anything.
Three men find themselves with no memory and few clues as to who or what they are.
I want to know what the factory actually is. We are more than likely the only three survivors.
Of what?
I don't know of what.
Backward-Compatible.com proudly presents...
This place is shut down.
I'm not going to follow him.
A 5-episode scenario developed by Adam Doc Bracken and Chris Krueger.
You see the old man crumpled in his chair.
We need to trust each other.
Run using the Primetime Adventures role-playing system.
I don't believe that's possible.
We didn't think so either.
Then obviously it can't be done.
But it has.
The Eden Program. Fridays on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, and BackwardCompatible.com.
So that was a little preview there for you of the Eden Program. Which we're very excited about. So there you go. So it was really cool having the other guys be a part of that. But Jim, what did you think of that? Don't give away any plot secrets or anything.
I certainly won't. But I had a great time playing. I thought I'd never played the system before. Do we want to?
Yeah, let's talk about the system actually, because that we really enjoy that system. Chris and I have done that system mm-hmm. before.
And what was the name of the system?
Primetime Adventures.
Primetime Adventures, yes, thank you. And I had never played that before. It's a very narrative-focused system.
It is. It very much is.
And I do like... I know that y'all made some tweaks to the system so that we could make the games flow a little better. Mm-hmm. But I thought it worked great.
Very few. It uses cards, so that's the first thing. And what you guys will hear whenever you listen to the first episode...
And a deck of regular playing cards.
Right,
to reinforce
regular
that for those
playing
is.
Cards. Yeah. And what you'll hear is that... the cards get dealt out, and then depending on the number of cards that you get based on your screen presence, or in the case of me, the GM/producer, which is the term that is used, you actually get to spend budget in order to get additional cards. And then the successes are all of the red cards, so the diamonds and hearts, that are actually revealed. Mm-hmm. Now, normally what you would do then is there's a hierarchy within that, and hearts trump over diamonds and so on and so forth.
And then I think lower number wins if you have the same suit.
Yeah, that sounds right. Mm-hmm. But we actually just simplified it so that it was all the red cards set the difficulty, and then if you can match the difficulty, you succeed.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So player wins ties, basically.
Right, player wins ties. And that actually worked really well for us. It was quick-paced, and it just kept things moving forward. But the cool thing about it is that the high card is the one who narrates. And yeah. So that was really interesting because... it made it so that every player was contributing to the setting, even though we had produced, in many ways, created the world. There were aspects that you guys contributed to that we had no idea was coming. And so that was really emergent. It was really fun. And we did a little thing, and again, teaser. You started with blank character sheets, which is not normal. But we worked that into the narrative in a fun way. So,
yeah, and I know when I was going through, I had the experience where, since I never played this game before, when it became my time to narrate early on, especially in the first episode, you know, I felt like I really wasn't sure how far I could go. So I was just, you know, I didn't want to ruin the story, ruin the GM's plans.
Right.
And I think all of us, I felt that Brian and Will had the same experience where... Mm-hmm. They were a little unsure about just how far they could push it. And as we continued, because we did all these episodes, we pre-recorded them all, and now we're going to send them out to y'all on a week-by-week basis.
Mm-hmm.
But as we continued with the episodes, we started getting into the groove of it, and I think it worked out really well.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Yeah. And what would happen typically is, you know, when we played the system for the first time, we actually did a 5-week campaign and took, you know, 3 to 4 hours per session.
Mm-hmm.
And we all sort of talked about what we were looking for in the story. So I developed the setting because I was the producer for that one. But we talked about kind of generally what we were thinking. Like, we like this mix of sci-fi and medieval, and we wanted to feel a little bit like Lost, but we also wanted to feel like this other thing, and yada yada. So I pulled from all that, and basically the players knew going into it both what their characters were supposed to be like, which means that when you're narrating, typically has something to do with your character. But also, mm-hmm. they knew sort of generally what the show was about, where it's going. And so it feels a lot more natural to be able to take over the narration and sort of take the reins for a little bit, direct the story. And that always works out really nicely. So it's a good system for that.
Indeed. Beyond that, this week, really technically it was last week, I went to a little store, a local store called Half Price Books.
Ah.
If you can find one that has a really good selection of games, actually you can pick up some classic games for great prices. It's really great. I personally like the one down off of Loop 12 here in Dallas. But
yeah, I've actually been to that one.
It's the big one.
They
actually have like two or three shelves worth of games down there, which is fantastic.
It's close to around where I live.
Yeah, and it wasn't at that store, but it was one over by where I usually go grocery shopping. But I picked up a little game, just a card game, called Edition Wars. Mm-hmm. Not Addition Wars, it's not math, it's Edition Wars. As
oh,
in
okay.
4th ed, 3.5.
Oh yeah, you were playing that at Madness the other day. Yeah.
And the premise behind the game is every player of the game is a game master, and they are trying to persuade, by any means possible, the gamers to come join their group. Hmm. The first group that has 6 players in it, so this is where it gets kind of confusing, because you are the player, but you're not the player, you're the GM. And within the context of the meta of the game that you are playing, called Edition Wars, you're trying to get players, which is cards.
Yes.
Perfectly clear. So the the first GM to get 6 players actually wins the game, but you steal them by blogging, and you steal them by doing other things. Snark is actually like a commodity, that kind of thing. And it's a cute little game. I don't know that it has high replay value, but it was a successful Kickstarter, which in and of itself was kind of neat. So it has some extra cards and things like that in it. But the reason why I bring it up specifically, aside from the fact that we've played it 3 or 4 times now, is there was a question that was brought up on a Facebook group that I am on, which is a board game group. It's one of the larger ones. The question was, are we approaching critical mass in board games? And so that's the question I actually want to pitch to you guys, is do you think we are hitting critical mass in maybe RPG systems or that sort of thing? And some of the comparisons that were brought up were like the comic book crash in the 90s, whenever you just couldn't buy you couldn't buy enough magazines to keep up.
I was in the thick of that, and I remember that, where everything sort of became... Well, first, part of that was also, a lot of that came from speculators kind of raising the price value of comics, thinking, if I buy this like special foil cover that they made millions of copies of,
uh-huh.
but it's going to be worth so much money because it's a collector's edition. They would put collector's edition on there.
Yeah.
So all these speculators would come in and think they were going to, you know, buy these comics and then save them for like a few years and then make lots of money.
Yeah.
Which, of course, if you're producing something, mass producing and marketing it as a collector's item, guess what? It's not a collector's item.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it is the same thing going on. Because aside from, I see what they're saying in terms of there's so much new stuff coming out, but there's not a whole lot of, maybe there's not as much inventiveness, perhaps. But is it really, is there a lot of like collector's editions and things like foil covers or the equivalent in tabletop games to really make that comparison?
Not that I've really seen. I think, like, you know, for instance, on Kickstarter, you'll have the backer rewards.
Right.
That kind of double as collector's edition sort of stuff because they're Kickstarter exclusive, or there's something in the game that only backers get, which there could be a ton of backers, but, you know, if it's a successful game that sells hundreds of thousands of copies, it's not going to... those people are going to outnumber the backers by quite a bit.
Right.
So I think that there is kind of occasionally the sense of, like, you know, things being marketed as being collectible, in that same sense, but I don't think board game publishers tend to think in that way.
I think, not necessarily, I don't think it's a board game issue. I don't think it's they're getting ready for some sort of crash. I think it's more of a Kickstarter and maybe even crowdfunding in general is reaching critical mass. That's the part that I think is reaching to the point where, you know, you give it another couple of years, it's not going to exist in the same format that it is. We're still in that state where people are willing to throw money at a project that they feel is cool and interesting, and they want to see. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that's going to last much longer, because there's been some projects that have been successful and have satisfied people, but there's been so many more that haven't. Mm-hmm. And I also think that at a certain point, you know, the big publishers are going to, there's going to be more and more pushback, and it's going to become a vehicle for large publishers to try to basically fund their stuff. Mm. And it's already, they've already been some that have sort of tested the waters with this. People from a lot of these big, you know, I don't want to name any names or anything, will get, well, I guess you technically did earlier in the show, but, there's definitely some designers that have their own companies or, that work for other large companies that go on Kickstarter in order to get funding for their games. And I think when you do that, it takes away some of that people, like we the people are funding a project by the people, you know, that kind of like mentality that Kickstarter started with. Mm-hmm. Is part of is you know, the lifeblood of crowdfunding. Once it starts catching on, oh well, these are just really people that have like some sort of a persona, but they're really working for a major company, and they're getting this money in order to make games for a major company, and we're just basically cutting out the, you know, producer/funding role. That's basically just us now. Once that dawns on people, and it's coming, people are starting to kind of catch on.
Mm-hmm.
There's
a cynicism.
It's gone,
and it's creeping in.
And of course, I'm not saying there's lots of still small projects going on in Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that crowdfunding is going to disappear. Mm-hmm. But I do think that it's going to be severely less popular, mm-hmm. and everywhere, and less profitable. And it's not going to be the sort of thing where... Because still, for now, indie studios can get by on Kickstarter. And I have a couple a friend studio... Triple B titles, they're still able to support themselves. They've taken two games now through Kickstarter, one of which is still in production. And they're just a small studio with three people, technically, that are on their team. I did some QA work for them and did a little bit on their first game as well. But they really have always been a very small studio and haven't really done much. You know, they're not like a large name or anything. There's a lot of little teams like that go through Kickstarter and build little projects, mm-hmm. and little games. And some of them I follow. I know Chasm is another sort of Metroidvania style game that went through Kickstarter successfully that I'm very interested in playing. So, you know, there's various little games like that are still around. But one of the reasons why they're able to make a good money is because of all the exposure that Kickstarter has. Mm-hmm. And I worry that this cynicism that we're talking about is going to creep in. It's already starting to creep in, mm-hmm. from these big studios trying to basically milk this. They're like, oh, here's a market that we haven't dominated yet. And once that happens, it's going to kill off. And you'll still be able to make some money on there, but I think it's these indie studios may actually struggle and possibly may not be able to stay open, many of them.
Yeah, it's interesting because, I mean, having just run a Kickstarter ourselves, me and Doc, you know, we were doing research on sort of like what the trends are in Kickstarter and kind of like the do's and don'ts, mm-hmm. of running a campaign.
That's right.
And I noticed when we were doing that research, even from, because I checked out Kickstarter when it first started and then kind of went away for a while and then sort of got reinterested in it again when we were about to do ours. And it had already evolved quite a bit. There was kind of like, there were different issues that I think were addressed very well by Kickstarter and by the community kind of like self-vetting itself, self-vetting the site, I should say, where they saw these disturbing trends and then, like, you know, Kickstarter started talking more about accountability, for example.
Right.
They started talking more about like, you know, the project guidelines of you should be using Kickstarter for this and not this. So I do think that...
Who was that guy that had a Kickstarter for? Was it making...
Potato salad,
thank you, which is absurd. And the whole, the people thinking, oh yeah, it's okay to just give him money, it's kind of funny, it's entertaining. No, you're actually ruining the whole concept, mm-hmm. and the whole process. And you're basically demeaning everyone that actually needs to use Kickstarter to succeed as a company, to survive. A lot of these small studios, people don't realize that.
Mm-hmm.
Don't really think about that. But there's a lot of indie studios that this is how they make money to live and to keep making games. I'm not saying they're gonna go in the poorhouse and be living on the street or anything,
mm-hmm.
but they wouldn't be able to have their own indie studio. They'd have to go find a job somewhere else. And by supporting something like a guy making potato salad, you might think it's funny to kick the guy $5,
mm-hmm.
but you're taking Kickstarter and you're adding this level of cynicism to it, and you're sort of revealing it for what it could potentially be, you know, abusing this mm-hmm. this trust.
And there's still a lot of people who, especially the older audience, you know, the audience you can tell that doesn't use the web too much, who hear about Kickstarter and just assume that it is people just giving money away for free.
Yeah.
They don't know anything about the backer rewards or the fact, like, basically the entire Kickstarter process. They just don't understand it. But there's still that perception out there that it's just, so I can ask for money and people will give it to me on the internet. You know, right. that's their understanding of what Kickstarter
yes.
is. And that's not a good image to have. Which, I mean, to Kickstarter's credit, I do think they combat that as well as they can. But there's still going to be a little bit of abuse that happens, and hopefully that will just sort of even itself out over time.
I think this is developing into a larger topic that I think that we should at some point discuss crowdfunding.
Well, it sounds like we need a soundbite that's stick a pin in it.
Yeah.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
All right, so quick Mobile Minute. Lately, I have been playing on my iPhone, my brand new iPhone 6, which I actually just got a few weeks ago. By the way, very, very nice having an updated phone now, because now my games don't lag horribly. It's always a plus. So now I'm able to appreciate mobile gaming again. But yeah, Hearthstone on phones, I believe, is fairly recent. They're still kind of advertising it as a new thing. It's like, hey, it's now on phones.
It sucked me back in about 3 weeks ago. So yeah.
And I know it's been on tablets for a while. So the fundamentals, I suppose, of the user interface and how, you know, you swipe to do everything, works really intuitively. It's really nice. And the interface, despite the size, and my phone is bigger than some might be, I imagine, but I think they do a good job of having the card zoom in just the right way. And when you zoom in, you're not risking playing them accidentally, because you have to actually swipe to play them, like tap and drag and release. So it's fairly error-proof, which is very nice. And it's really cool to be able to pass a few minutes, just when you're out and about with a quick game. I played it on the plane on the way back from Germany. Actually, it's a really good time burner. And being able to, for a game that's all about kind of like rising in the ranks and just sort of hopping on and playing a few quick games every now and then, having the cross-platform support is really nice. I definitely recommend Hearthstone for mobile devices.
Cool. This has been the Mobile Minute.
And this has been the Mobile Minute.
So now we're going to transition to sort of the main segment of our show. And today's topic is going to be focused on lore in games, and particularly lore in terms of world building and how it reinforces the narrative and sort of gives us extra information for the game that is not necessarily told through the linear narrative of the story of the game. I know this is something that I've been thinking a lot about, because I've been playing Witcher 3, or The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, to be more specific.
Wild Hunt.
There is definitely a narrative in Witcher 3, which actually, so far, I think is fairly strong. But the lore itself in the world and the way that it's built up hints at so like a very rich atmosphere and a very a rich world with a lot of depth to it, that they really could have just gone with something that just kind of gone with the main story, just kind of had, oh, it's just a medieval world with some monsters in it.
Yeah.
But they didn't. And a lot of that, of course, is because, like we said, it's from a Polish novel series. There was a lot of information to pull from.
Mm-hmm.
But I think lore, the main reason I wanted to talk about this too, is that the concept of giving too much away. Because every time, when you're making with some of these big game projects, you'll put together a story bible mm-hmm. of information that you feel is important to help you sort of build, flesh the world out. And, a lot of times you don't want to put out all that information. You put out, snippets of it here and there, and some of the stuff is only hinted at, and some of it you only use to inform you as the designer about
right.
how something may be designed. But it's never even shown to the player. Other times, some companies will put out all this information in various platforms and sometimes even try to sell the story bible itself,
mm-hmm.
Which I always have felt is sort of a big... No.
Mm.
But what do y'all think about this concept of doing a story bible and then hinting or giving full information, all this extra meta content that sort of builds the lore of the story?
Well, I think it's interesting that we're talking about this also, and I think I mentioned this to you guys when we were discussing what the topic was going to be, and that is that in creative writing, not even necessarily games, but just writing, say a novel or a movie or whatever the case might be, you know, in fantasy and science fiction especially, you do a lot of world building to figure out what your world's all about and what's in it and who's who.
And what are the rules of your world?
Yeah, exactly.
Which is a big part.
Definitely a big part. And so this is all very important work, and you can spend a ton of time just trying to come up with all this stuff. And in a way, it's kind of frustrating because it doesn't always appear to the reader. You know, it's very important that you do it, because if you don't, it's going to show. But you still need to, you need to go through it and do the work. And there's a common problem. And actually, when I was taking a creative writing class at the university, one of the professors I had actually had this rule that you can't write science fiction and fantasy by extension in his class. And the reason for that is because there's this trap the writers fall into where when they do all this world building, they turn their stories into, let me spew stuff about the world. Let me just go exposition all up on you for, you know, pretty much the entire story.
Oh, you mean explain the world and its rules when really you should be telling your story and let the rules kind of let the reader figure them out.
Yeah, it's basically the characters, the story doesn't become about the characters. And this is the problem, that the good stories are ultimately about the characters, whatever else you do. You can get by or you can get away with a lot of problems with your story if you have good characters. Say plot, for example. The plot doesn't have to be super strong if the characters are really strong. Whereas if you have weak characters and the best plot ever, you might have issues. So when you don't focus on the characters in your story, you focus too much on the world. That's a very dangerous trap, and I think that applies to video games as well. And that's why it's kind of an interesting discussion to have as to, you know, how do you reveal information and how much, and you know, that sort of thing, both in gaming and in other creative writing.
I would agree about not focusing on, you know, the exposition aspect and directly telling people, but I would disagree on the idea of directly translating that concept of character being the most important to video games, because that's not necessarily true. It really depends on what game you're talking about. I think with games, it's not necessarily the character, because it's more the story told through the atmosphere in the world.
Mm.
But again, you don't want to directly tell them about the world. You want to show them the world. Mm. And that's where I think the difference is.
Cue the Aladdin music.
Right. And it's we'll throw that in. But it's fine, I think. And that is, I think, a general rule of storytelling that I think translates to games. The show, don't tell rule.
Mm.
And I think that's everywhere.
And I think,
that's what you're talking about, really, when you talk about the exposition. Yeah. You're saying don't tell them about the world.
Mm.
Show them the world through the story and through the characters.
Right, And actually, I think that we're actually more in agreement on that than you would think, about the characters being the most important part. Mm. Just in games, it comes the player.
Yeah,
and the
player's
experience.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm with you.
You got me.
And so, yeah, there you go.
I changed my mind.
We agree. Woo!
All right, podcast over. We're done.
Well, that makes me think of, what's the game called? Dark Space?
Dark Souls?
No, not that one. The one where...
Dead Space.
Dead Space, thank you. I don't know why I can never remember that game. Well, mostly because, actually, I hated the gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
I absolutely, truly despised the gameplay in that game. Yet, I have such admiration for the level builders of that game.
Environmental storytelling.
Yes, that I actually went ahead and watched the Let's Plays so that I could get the story, because the story was kind of compelling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, zombies in space, whatever. And at the same time, I absolutely loved the stories that were told about, look what happened in this room when the terrible thing broke out.
Mm-hmm.
And I still have not yet come across a game that does that better. Some that do it as well.
Mm-hmm.
But when you compare that to, say, Skyrim.
Yeah.
You know, you've got these wonderful opportunities to tell these types of stories with, like, the Dwemer. You're going into an ancient race's abandoned, cave, if for lack of a better word, hold. And you could be telling this amazing, fantastic story about the dwarves that were in this particular place. But instead, what you get is, oh, good, it's another one. And I find myself just you know, looking for loot and for... dwarven metal, and there's no narrative, there's no backstory narrative happening there.
I'm very glad you brought up Skyrim, because this is my problem with the Elder Scrolls series in general. And even though I can say that I've generally speaking enjoyed the ones that I've played up to a point, I really dislike how they expect you to read whole bunch of different books, like tomes, literal books inside the game,
yeah,
to flesh out your knowledge of the game world, so that you have, because they want they want to give you this background information so that later on when you know guards are mentioning some, you know, random event or someone in town says something, or you get they want you to sort of have that background knowledge so that you can go, oh yeah, this happened, and you can feel like you know more about the world, but you have to read all of this.
Well, to be fair, those books are on average about 4 pages long,
but I mean that's the sort of information that should be showing. They should be showing you in the world, like,
and not
like,
telling you,
right? With, yeah, the Dwemer stuff is a great example, and you know I don't feel like I have to read any of the, you know, the only thing that they have in The Witcher 3, for example, is they have some bestiary information, which are usually little anecdotal tales that talk and that, you know, like a paragraph, and then a little bit of information that the Witcher might know about how to defeat them.
Mm-hmm.
But that's basically it, and you don't feel like you have to read these little backstories. There's a lot of backstories and stuff that you learn as you play the game because of the way that the world is sort of set up.
Sure.
So it's done, I think, a lot more subtly, and I think that's the key is subtlety. You don't want to just throw a whole bunch of stuff at the player that is just pure text that you expect them to have to read in order to get that experience of, oh, this is a rich world that has all this background information to it. I think Elder Scrolls and Bethesda in general are a little too, hey, look at how much work we did, look at how much writing and work we took into building this world, as opposed to if they want to show off, they want to show it off a little bit too much, and I think that's the wrong way to go about it. You want to have it there, but let the player find it if they want to find it, instead of making them feel like they're missing something if they don't.
And I would think that their argument would be that that's what they're doing right now.
Yeah,
is that the average player is thinking that, oh, I have the option to go read these books I want to, but I don't care, so I'm just going to go and do the core gameplay.
But then the game is the world itself and the story is extremely bland.
Yeah, I do. It is extremely bland
if you don't do that.
My experience with Skyrim, I would describe much of it as being empty feeling.
Yes,
the narrative felt very hollow.
Every time that I brought that up to someone that is a huge Elder Scrolls fan, they always say, "Oh, but you got to read all these, you know, the lore and the books and all this, and there's so much of the world there." And while that may be true, the presentation of that is to the point. It's not the way. To me, I mean, I don't want to say it's not the way the game should be, but that's kind of the way I feel.
It's possible for you to even be a fan of, like, a long time fan of the series and not know any of that stuff.
Oh, very possible.
I've never played any of the others. Skyrim's the only one I've played.
I've played a little bit of Morrowind and a little bit of Oblivion. A touch.
I had a roommate who played a little bit of...
I played those two, and I played Daggerfall as well for a while.
Daggerfall.
Daggerfall as well somewhat recently, actually, going back to it. Which is an interesting experience in and of itself, yes.
Oh, wow.
Actually, for a while, I was playing around with the concept of doing, Let's Play videos.
Yeah.
And recording myself as I was playing, and I didn't feel as comfortable with it, but it was an interesting experience just because it's very hard, but in a way that feels... I sort of had a similar feeling from when I was playing Dark Souls, where it's a very brutal sort of experience, where you have to constantly be running back and hiding and that kind of thing.
You know, that one still holds the record for largest landmass in a video game.
Yeah, but they cheat.
They do. It's procedural. So, but, I mean, it's...
The other thing that it cheats, too, is that it's so much of it is empty, and so much of it is just there's nothing there.
Does it beat Minecraft?
Well...
I would say yes, but no, technically someone could create something bigger from Minecraft.
Minecraft is supposed to be 8 times the size of Earth.
Like real size Earth.
Yeah, and only through cheats can you get to the edge of the map. But that one's a finite size that's like 4 times the size of Great Britain.
Mm-hmm.
So I would argue that Daggerfall deserves it.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, at least when the record was... being compared, first off, there was the argument that because there wasn't a win state, Minecraft shouldn't have been able to compete in that sense. There was more simulation than narrative. So,
I would still contend that that's the game. Even though that you can technically beat it, that's not what is compelling about Minecraft. What is drawing people in? And I'm not really a Minecraft fan, but I think that it's clear to me that what draws people into that game is, you know, the ability to create and the, you know, the sort of, like, ownership that they feel they can have over the system. Not so much, can I, you know, kill this thing and beat the game.
Yeah. Super strong modding community, super strong vidding community. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In fact, I just recently got back into watching the Augscast after taking about a year off from watching them, because that was becoming a problem of sorts. It was interfering with my ability to function as a human because they had so many channels and so much content all the time. Mm. But I'm a Shin fanboy, I have to admit. Okay. He's cool. I wish I could build like him.
So speaking of The Witcher as kind of like being a good example of lore being presented.
And there's others. I don't know if I can bring up some others.
Yeah, I was about to mention that BioWare tends to do a pretty good job with that, I think.
I would say they did an excellent job in the first BioShock. I'm sorry. Are we talking about... I'm talking about the wrong games.
BioWare is Dragon Age and Mass Effect.
Yes,
and,
thank you. I would say...
Dungeons & Dragons, the old school stuff.
I would say only their early stuff. I would say no for Mass Effect.
I really...
I would say Mass Effect and Dragon Age had the same problem as Elder Scrolls. I would say that there's more to it, but it still felt like you had to read too much. I think...
I don't know. I thought that I learned what I needed to know to understand people's motivations and stuff through conversations.
Yeah, but did you read the codex? Because every time something pops up that's new, it's like, there's a new journal entry. Yeah,
I did read the codex, but I didn't read it like my first time through. Now that being said, you know, there are a few things that say, like, I didn't play Mass Effect 1. Mm-hmm. And I found out there are certain things I later learned in the codex that are also mentioned in 1, so I didn't need to read the codex to learn that stuff. I do find the codex stuff to be interesting. It adds more depth. But I think that, you know, I think Dragon Age, for example, does tend to feel a little bit like it's kind of generic dark fantasy.
They have some
interesting twists. Yeah. But, you know, even to just take away the genericness, I felt like I understood the factions and their histories and stuff like that well enough just through the presentation of the main story that I didn't need to read everything else to get
there. I think it's not just... When I talk about lore, I'm not just talking about them directly giving you a book or a codex or something to read. I'm also talking about them... In the actual narrative, the people that you talk to are directly giving you story information and exposition.
It's ham-fisted.
And that I feel like happens a lot in Mass Effect and Dragon Age, whereas I don't get that impression with Witcher. When I'm talking to people, that's a fair point. They hint at things. Mm-hmm. When I'm going through a town, a little kid is like singing some song that gives me an implication of what is the system of government like,
mm-hmm.
and how do people perceive what they can say and what they can't say.
Mm-hmm.
Just from like a little song and how the parent is reacting to the kid singing that song. Mm-hmm. Things like that.
Yeah,
that's what I'm talking about with lore. And I think that's one of my biggest problems with Mass Effect and Dragon Age is that they're so insistent on pushing their story. It's like, hey, look how clever we are.
Mm-hmm.
And I say this as a person who's a huge BioWare fan back in the day when they did the first Baldur's Gate, Baldur's Gate 2, the early BioWare stuff, which I think was really kind of their peak. And then after that, I feel like at a few of the projects I kind of liked, but they never really hit that same peak. And I never really got into Mass Effect and Dragon Age. I understand, you know, a lot of people did, and they're a very popular series, but I just was never able... I played all the way through the first one, Mass Effect 2, and then I also played Dragon Age and part of Dragon Age 2. Mm. So it's not like I haven't played these games.
Sure, yeah.
I tend to like
the newer stuff better than the older stuff, and part of that's just because... I never played those like classic dungeon crawl sort of RPGs back when they were, you know, the thing. And now that if I try to go back to it, I just find that it's not really my style.
And that's fine. And I think with The Witcher, I think it does strike a good balance because one of the issues with the old Baldur's Gate games is because they're so strategic that unless you're into playing, you know, sort of controlling, micromanaging your entire party.
Mm-hmm. Which I am not.
Right. it's maybe a game that you may not be able to get into from a gameplay perspective, which is fine.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I do think something like The Witcher, where you're playing as one character,
and it
gives you this experience where it is very much like a open world Skyrim style game, just with much more refined combat, because the action in it is designed to be like, say, to use a comparison... like a God of War or Assassin's Creed, that kind of thing, where it's like an actual action game. Right, whereas, like, Skyrim's not really... The action in Skyrim is just you're swinging your sword.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's got more of an action element to it, in addition to the RPG elements, in addition to the world building.
Cool.
Not to gush too much about it, but it is an excellent game.
Yeah, I've been hearing great things about it, yeah.
You know, another example, a couple other examples of this to throw them out. I don't know if y'all have ever played either of them, but they're both by the designer Matsuno... Oh gosh, I want to say his other name is Takahashi. He did Final Fantasy Tactics and Tactics Ogre.
Mm-hmm.
They're both strategy RPGs, Japanese.
This isn't the guy who did Bravely Default, is it? Or is that somebody else?
That is, I believe, someone else.
Okay.
No, these are... either of y'all play these games? Final Fantasy Tactics or Tactics Ogre?
I played a little bit of Tactics, and I played Advance, which I don't think is the same guy. But
It's not, but it's the same world, and it's a similar gameplay system, but the story is significantly simplified in Tactics Advance.
Which we've talked about it.
Yes. But the cool thing about both of these games is that you sort of play as a character that is almost like a forgotten person in history. Like, there's this greater war going on.
Mm-hmm.
And you are just one person in this conflict that is doing something sort of tangentially related that is kind of important in its own way to the story. Go ahead.
What little I have played of Tactics, actually, I do recall that the introduction is basically, it's prefaced as this historian discovering this unknown figure from history that kind of got covered up by the powers that be.
Yes.
And what he's doing is, like, basically as you play through the game, he's discovering these records of what happened.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a really cool idea.
Yeah, actually. And there's a lot to it. There's this, Matsuno's kind of really big war buff, a lot of these conflicts over in... Europe, and I want to say he based Tactics on the Balkan War, Balkan conflicts.
Oh, the Balkans.
Yeah, and I know that. I'm sorry, that's for Tactics Ogre.
Mm.
Final Fantasy Tactics, he based that on the War of the Roses, which is a more simple concept, but still a lot to it compared to a lot of the other Final Fantasy games. But just using that as another example of something where you have all this sort of story going on in the background, and you're not even the main player, you could say, in terms of the overall politics of the world.
Right.
You have your own story, but there's all this other story going on that is in some ways more important to the grand scheme of things. And that's another way to go about having this, this lore and this background and have all this stuff, as opposed to them coming out and saying, this is what's happening inside the politics. This is what's happening over here.
Right.
It's there, but you have to kind of seek it out, and you have to get snippets of it here and there. And that's what I'm talking about. That I like when I'm talking about lore and what I think, Doc was talking about when it comes to the visual presentation of that, which is, you come into a room and the way that the levels are designed, and when you mentioned BioWare, because I was a little tired, I'm thinking of BioShock, that is, I think, a good example. Less so Infinite, but...
Actually, BioShock is a fantastic
example. The first BioShock had so much story being told through the level design of the world.
Mm-hmm.
I think that maybe they bit off more than they can chew. Maybe they didn't have the focus in Infinite. I didn't really get as much of a sense of that.
Well, if you look at some of the early interviews with Ken Levine with BioShock, you can tell he had direct control over it.
Right.
He waited frighteningly long to actually write the dialogue at the end, but he was still pretty much directly controlling the environments and that sort of a thing.
Right.
The second one, he gave the pitch, then he was off the project, and...
that may have been why.
That was the main reason why 2 was so terrible. For example...
I thought BioShock 2 was good.
Well, I liked...
Much better than Infinite, in my opinion.
Yes, but I liked the DLC, actually, in 2. I thought the DLC in 2 was pretty good.
That's very good.
But the Big Sister subplot was actually supposed to be... the big boss, and it was supposed to be a big sister, and she was supposed to be your nemesis as the thing, and that pitch would have been brilliant. That was Levine's original idea, as I understand it. And what happened was that they were then stuck with, we need 80% of the content, and we don't know what to do. Oh, cut and paste, cut and paste, cut and paste. Let's have a bunch of big sister fights. It worked for the first one. And that just didn't work as well, because then it wasn't an individual little sister who had come back to become a big sister. It was just this sort of class of enemy, and that was so weak, in my opinion, that it ruined some things for me. But that said, Infinite, I played the demo for Infinite, and it was brilliant. It was absolutely fantastic. It was amazing. It was wonderful. And the reason is that it was a mashup of all of the most clever parts.
Oh yeah.
And I kept waiting for that level to come, and it never came. And I finished the thing, and I realized that I had actually, in fact, played just about every aspect of the other. But we talk about it in terms of show, don't tell. There's a revolution going on, and you shift into that universe, and it's already happened. You did all the cool things as a different character. Hello? Talking about missing the mark. So... yeah, I've heard the comparison that Infinite was a great little story, except for all those guns. Actually, I kind of agree with that.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't want to get, you know, too off on a tangent about just Infinite and Disappointment. This is an older game, but yeah. I do think that there was some interesting environment. We're just talking about the environment and the level design. Mm-hmm. There were some things that were you know, interesting about it, but I just think that it felt like there was a lot more personal touches and love put into the detail of the world and inside the first BioShock, to the point where it felt like a fully realized
not just the art, but lived actually.
Yeah,
that part still sticks in my nightmares sometimes.
Yeah.
That whole level where he's turning people into statues and that sort of thing, and as you go into a room, you see that he's been there, and you see the terrible atrocities that he's committing. It's like, oh my, this guy's a freak. But to draw the circle, to complete the circle back to Witcher, actually, ironically, one of the reasons why I have not even approached that game or really even followed or been interested in that game is because it has a 3 after it. And I've always been that way until someone said, no, you have to go get Skyrim. You have to play Skyrim. And I watched some Skyrim and I'm like, you know what? I think I would enjoy that.
Yeah.
It wasn't even on my radar. And that's the way it is with these series. I mean, I've played every Assassin's Creed out there since the beginning, and I'm bored.
I actually
ended up breaking, it's not actually called 5, it's called Rogue.
Rogue.
I ended up breaking Rogue because you make kind of an alignment shift, and my playstyle is as an explorer, so I just explored the world, and I went out there, and you can basically go commit terrible crimes, and they just kind of, the French will look at you and be like, oh, hello, welcome to our village, you are our friend. So,
yeah.
You know, and it doesn't make any sense. There was a core mechanic there that should have been there that wasn't. And this all ties in together to me as the same thing. I'll give one more example, and then I'll throw it back to you, which is, with the original BioShock, there was this wonderful emergent property that occurred whenever they had designed the system so very, very well that objects could be moved with telekinesis, that whenever they playtested, they discovered that a tripwire could actually be moved with telekinesis, which is something they had never expected. They didn't design it to do that, but the physics system was so good, and it was an object, that it became something that you could strategically do. And the same with setting a teddy bear on fire and being able to throw it and things like that. Just these sort of emergent play styles. And I feel like we've lost some of that in the shiny, shiny, pretty, pretty of PS4 generation. Which is ironic because people are complaining that the graphics isn't as good as they showed us at E3.
Yeah. I think, and they're complaining about that too with Witcher, which I think, you know, who cares? It's not a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I think because they're, you know, an Eastern European company, I don't know, but the Witcher games, having played all of them but never really getting that far, I got maybe about halfway to three quarters of the way through the other ones. I feel that it's almost like they're sort of perfecting their style and their gameplay, and, you know, more fully realizing the story with each new edition.
I think they're self-published.
Yes.
And so I think Richard was talking about last week that, you know, they have to kind of make a few conceits here and there.
Yes.
But it's still
very well done. And I love how when you first get the game and you open it up, they give you this, and I didn't buy a special edition or anything. It was just, I bought the game.
Mm-hmm.
And you open it up and they give you, there's this little like card right when you first open the little case, and it says, you know, from CD Projekt Red, is like, oh yeah, thanks for downloading our game. Here's, you know, 15 DLC or whatever that we want you to download for free. Here, come to our site. You know, it's like, they're very, like, open. Like, here's, they give you, like, these little stickers, like Witcher stickers. They give you, like, this little map that goes with the game. And, like, they're, right off the bat, you feel like, hey, this is a company that actually wants you to play their game and isn't trying to, like, you know, throw a bunch of crap at you. They're like, here, have some stuff, some stuff. We want you to play. We're so excited to be making games for you.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is great. And so, you know, and then you play the game and there's just all this depth to it. Like you were talking about, you know, the player and going into the room and one of the things that you get in Witcher, which I really like, I've liked so far, is the way that people react to you is always very interesting because you talk about the, you know, French Revolution issue and all that in Assassin's Creed. Well, in this one, Witchers are sort of, they're seen as a necessary evil because they have to, someone has to go out and slay monsters, and Witchers are uniquely qualified to do so because they've enhanced their bodies with, like, monster parts to survive monster attacks and be more you know, athletic and agile and see things that no one else can see and all this.
Reminds me a bit of Claymore, but that's an aside.
Yeah, but at the same, I think these stories were probably written before, because Claymore's kind of somewhat recent. But anyway,
so it's
The way that people react to you, even though they know that you're kind of necessary, at the same time, everyone sort of treats you like you're some sort of a freak and a monster, because you kind of are part monster. So you're not really very well trusted in town. People will sometimes, like, try to kill you. You have to figure out how you're going to react. And I get the impression in the game, too, that you're sort of almost like this... I don't know if they were influenced by it, but it feels almost like you're almost like a magic Jedi in some scenes, because... One of the powers that you have is the power to influence people's minds. So you can literally just pull Jedi mind tricks on people. Or I guess it would be a Witcher mind trick. You know, like someone wants to fight you because you're a Witcher and you're talking in town, and so you can like steal their mind and make them do things or make them, you know, not care about you. Things like that. So it's kind of cool how you have all these different abilities and these different ways that people react to you and treat you. It feels, at least so far, and I'm not super far in the game, not at all, there's a lot of content, it so far at least, it feels consistent, and it feels like I'm in a, you know, persistent world that is well thought out.
Cool.
A lot of depth there.
So one sort of flash topic I want to bring up related to lore and world building and stuff like that. And it's not, well, I guess it does have to do with the presentation. I'm thinking specifically of, we'll use the Warcraft universe, because I imagine we're all fairly familiar with it.
Oh, yeah.
Where they've got a lot of, obviously, expanded universe stuff that is kind of like part of the lore that does come up sometimes in the games, but sometimes not at all. And what I find interesting to say in World of Warcraft, when they have to keep coming up with new content, new things that will happen, sometimes they come up with, like, you know, new things that happen in the story that are supposed to be significant events that I felt sometimes are... they don't seem to fit entirely well with kind of like the established stories that have come up through the other games. And part of the problem is that it's so massive. And especially if you've got a game that's going on for 10 plus years and you're trying to come up with a new story for it. I don't know, do you guys just have any thoughts about like how to handle sort of like a game where you have to keep expanding the universe in order to create new content?
Do you mean that, because I know at a certain point, Warcraft, World of Warcraft, ran out of Warcraft stories to tell. So they had, like, Starcraft lore to tell, so they had to start coming up with their own for World, like, that, because that happened, I believe, after... Wrath of Lich King, didn't it? You can correct me if I'm wrong on this one.
There were a couple times they came up with entirely new ideas even before Wrath.
Right, but I'm talking about the main concept behind the expansion, is what I mean. Like, for example, Pandas is the biggest example, where that became, you know, they had this whole story and stuff behind it specifically for that World of Warcraft expansion. It didn't come
from... the sense that it was kind of...
It was for World of Warcraft. It wasn't. Right. We're taking lore that we had done years before.
Okay, I see. So it's not derived from something that happened in an earlier game,
and already had a bunch of extra stuff.
I think there were a few other things.
Was the last one, right?
Yeah, I think there were a few other things. Like if we're ignoring expansions and we're just saying like maybe new content that opens up just like as a patch or something.
Yeah,
occasionally those patches would add new stuff like that. But yeah, as far as expansions go, Mists of Pandaria, it was basing the Pandarian race on like
Kung Fu Panda.
Yeah,
we all know.
No, well, that too. But you know, in Warcraft 3, there was a faction neutral hero called the Brewmaster, so the Pandaren Brewmaster, and it was just this hero class you could play as, and I think that was about it as far as where the panda, what they were, where they came from. And then Mists of Pandaria really expanded upon their culture and stuff to make the expansion, which I've not played that one, so I can't really speak to too much. But yeah, Wrath of the Lich King was based on
Frozen Throne,
Frozen Throne, and the whole story of Arthas that went through Warcraft 3. The Burning Crusade had to do with, you know, the history of like where the orcs came from. They added some other stuff with, like the Draenei, or rather fleshed out the Draenei some more. So yeah, I mean, like until then, everything had been based on previous stuff. And to a degree, I'm not sure I'm a huge fan of at least the presentation of, like, you know, these boss fights where you just have like 40 people who, you know, take down, you know, the villain or whatever. It just doesn't feel like the other stories did. But that's just a kind of a problem with MMOs.
You mean with just the new... Are you talking about any 40-man raid, or you mean just the newer 40-man raids?
Well, not the newer ones, just, like, the fact that...
You just mean the concept, like, in general?
The concept in general, that, like, you go and you fight Arthas, and he's just a boss that you're going to defeat. And it doesn't feel like it's significant to the story.
I agree in terms of, like, narratively speaking, but I think in terms of... agency in the gameplay, and you actually
the player
accomplishing. Yeah. I think it feels very epic.
That feels huge. Yeah,
yeah.
I just don't. It kind of pains me as a fan of the narrative to be like, right. And Arthas just goes down to a group of 40 people after accumulating these like massive. And of course, they try to explain it to is
we're
like,
all badasses if we can take him out. You're
supporting like the mission that's like slowly creeping up on his domain and eventually taking him down. But I don't know. I wasn't a huge fan of that, necessarily.
Mm.
Zelda is my answer.
Mm.
Legend of Zelda.
Yeah.
How many Zelda games have there been now? 13? 14? More? I don't know.
Possibly.
Pretty much from the beginning, you had a given set of components that can be ascribed to Zelda.
Mm-hmm.
And then every new game adds kind of a new thing. Like, mm-hmm. I remember when the shot put first came about, and then suddenly it's like iconic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, hook shot, right?
Hook shot, yeah.
Whatever.
I actually thought you were talking about like the ball and chain that you have in Twilight Princess. Like you kind of like toss it at people.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. I was actually talking about the hook shot.
Cool too, actually. I remember that. Now you bring it up.
Yeah, that's true, actually.
Or Twilight Princess turning into the wolf.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The idea of a dark world or you know, something like that came about in Link to the Past, mm-hmm. basically. But my point is this. It's the same game, but it's not. It's the same Link, but it's not. Recently they came out with a timeline, kind of linking all the worlds and how it split and that kind of thing, which is really kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously not designed that way.
Yeah.
It was retconned.
I kind of hate the concept of the timeline. For me...
Do you?
For me, Legend of Zelda is the same story...
Told
in a different way. Mm-hmm. A different bard is telling the tale, and this time Link is this old, and this mm-hmm. time the story takes place in this world, and this happens.
I kind of liked the idea that a few of them were connected at least, but I didn't have any need for them all to be connected.
And that's how we can think of the Star Wars lore now.
Mm-hmm.
From all the extended universe.
That'll be its own mm-hmm. podcast.
Just a different...
And it will be fun to...
Stick a pin in it.
Oh, yeah. Ooh, that's gonna be a salty episode, I can tell you right now, because I get really fired up about Star Wars. It's one of my first big loves when growing up.
Mentioned it then. Zelda, Legend of Zelda series is my answer to that, because it's so interesting. It's kind of like every generation has its own Batman, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Every generation now has its Link as well, at least of gamers. And, you know, Legend of Zelda was like the second video game I ever played, if you don't include Pong and, I don't know, Q-Bert or something.
Yeah. Up there on my list,
at least on my home console it was.
Mm-hmm.
So it's funny because it has a great, great place in my heart, and I haven't touched any of the new ones because I just can't stomach them anymore. It's the same content recycled into a new, shinier coat, and I'm not talking about when Wind Waker came out and everybody went, the graphics are terrible, and
now they love them.
And then grew up because that was 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about that at all. It's about you have your version, your entry, your one that you beat first and the one that you love. And it's like your first girlfriend, your first kiss, you know, whatever. And the truth is, I just don't think the original Legend of Zelda has that much replay value for me. But it's the one
really?
That's kind of in my heart.
I love the original Legend of Zelda.
Yeah.
I love the series. I'll be honest. I'm a huge Legend of Zelda fan.
You have it memorized?
The first one?
Yeah. Can you do a run in like 3 hours now?
Probably less.
I know somebody who can. So
probably less. See, you know, easily. I know the entire game. I know the second quest. Same thing. I can do this. I know also all of Zelda 2. I played that one to death as well.
Mm-hmm.
Link's Awakening, I think I can do the same thing. Game Boy
one. But see, that's my point.
I love those games.
The wonderment of discovery is gone for you in that.
Oh, that and I agree with. But that's why I get so much excitement from new Zelda games, because it brings that back for a time. I think that some of them have been disappointing. I wouldn't say that all of them are hit it out of the park.
Sure.
But for example, the most recent release, Link Between Worlds, was excellent. Was a very well done.
Was
of
it?
Course, it was built in a similar style to Link to the Past, but it was also very different. And I think it does bring that. I think the last 3D Zelda that I felt that the same way about would probably be Twilight Princess, mm-hmm. even though I think Wind Waker was excellent as well. Wind Waker is probably my favorite 3D Zelda.
Mm-hmm.
I don't hold Ocarina of Time in as high a regard as some people do. Mm-hmm. I liked it for what it was, but I didn't play it when it first came out, and maybe that's why.
Mm.
I do feel that it has not aged that well, personally. And I'm talking gameplay-wise, not visuals.
Sure, yeah.
You compare that to the gameplay in, say, Twilight Princess, and it's miles, miles better mm-hmm. than Twilight Princess. Mm-hmm. Enemies don't stand around and walk in a circle around you mm-hmm. and then attack you one at a time and then back off.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they do in Ocarina of Time.
Wait, we're talking about Assassin's Creed again? What?
It drove me nuts. Twilight Princess, they can get really clever
mm-hmm.
when they come at you. They can use shields and they'll attack you in a certain way and they'll jump over mm-hmm. you and attack you from both sides.
I recall when Twilight Princess came out, there were some people who were complaining that it wasn't really innovative enough, but I've also heard it described as the best form of that style of Zelda. That it is the refined version of what Ocarina of Time was trying to be at the time. They just kept improving, improving.
I really feel that it was too.
Mm-hmm. So I guess the reason for bringing that all up in the context of lore is I don't think there's any gamer who's, a Zelda fan who wouldn't be able to tell you what Zelda is about mm-hmm. and what each of those iconic things represents.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, which game are we talking about? The answer is it doesn't matter. And so there's something to that for me.
Mm.
I'm waiting for the reboot of insert property here.
Mm-hmm. I think we're getting that with a new Legend of Zelda. One of the things we are getting that's going to come out soon, it's trying to go back to the original Legend of Zelda style, which was almost... The first Legend of Zelda was almost an open-world game before we had open-world games.
Mm-hmm.
And then, very quickly, with the next one, but especially with Link to the Past, the next one was sort of like side-scroller action, so it sort of was a departure. Zelda 2, even though I loved it, it was a departure. But Link to the Past really was the one that defined the Zelda style.
Yeah,
it wasn't really the first one. And maybe that's why I didn't like Link to the Past.
There was a whimsy in that one that...
Yeah, and maybe that's why I didn't like it as much. But it became much more structured. Mm-hmm. And since then, the Legend of Zelda games have been more structured.
Mm-hmm. I think
you have to do them in a certain order. You have to do things a certain way. Mm-hmm. And there's less of that exploration to it, mm-hmm. than in the original.
I think they're going back to that now.
That's what they want to go back to in the new one for Wii U.
There's an interesting universality about that particular game, too. Because while I played it on, what was it, Super Nintendo... a lot of my students, when I taught high school, also played it because it had just come out on
Game Boy Advance.
And so it was interesting how that one had it hit two generations,
right.
in the heart zone.
And it was very well made. Don't get me wrong, but I felt that it really missed out on that sense of discovery as its main feature.
Yeah,
in the original, and you could do things in any order. Mm-hmm. That feature as well.
Yeah, Aaron Hansen, Ego Raptor, put it pretty well in one of his videos. He was basically saying that A Link to the Past was the first one kind of that had essentially, like, he put up the map and said, like, here's where you go essentially in order, because it tells you need to go to this place and do this thing. And he said it doesn't feel like exploring, then it feels like a tour.
Yeah.
You're being taken on a guided tour across all the points of the map rather mm-hmm. than just being free to go explore as you choose. I would even argue to a degree that while it's different from that, because it doesn't tell you which order to do the dungeons in, the fact that A Link Between Worlds, which is, I guess, the new one.
Yes.
So A Link to the Past, Link Between Worlds, yeah. They still say you're going to have to hit all 8 of these dungeons at some point. And so it doesn't really matter which order you do it in. You have the freedom of choice there. So it's like, oh, I'm in the mood to do this one, I guess. But you're still going to have to do all of them at some point.
It is definitely, I would say, they did experiment with some more freedom in that one. Mm. So I will give it credit.
Mm-hmm.
I will definitely say that Link Between Worlds, for me, was a much better game than Link to the Past.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's a divisive comment, I don't know, but I personally feel that way. But yeah, like, just, I guess to close out the discussion, I do totally agree that... one thing I do want to, with that concept, with Legend of Zelda, and I do think that maybe this is something that we can talk about for a later day, another time, later podcast, but the idea of the NES games and the experimentation that was put in there and sort of like a lot of these experimental ideas that later became refined and structured with their Super Nintendo counterparts
mm-hmm.
and how that, because that's something that happened with Metroid too, and that's something that happened with Super Mario Brothers, and it's something that might be interesting to talk about and to say, hey, was this really a good thing, and or was this both a good and a bad thing? That did we lose something, possibly by gaining something else, but did we lose something in the process?
I think what we started to see there, without getting too deep into it now, is I think in short you can sort of say that it came down to usability, where the more structured and the more linear something is, the more accessible it is. And when you're trying to sell games, it's very hard to strike the right balance between being accessible to the majority of players while being open-ended enough for the core players.
I think, and I'll leave it with this note, and y'all can disagree with me if you want, but I think that initially with the NES, I felt like games, especially adventure games, you said it as a general term, were meant for you to be lost in. You were going to play it, and it was going to take you months to beat it. You were going to take months to beat Legend of Zelda. You were going to take months to beat Metroid, unless you called some sort of hintline or something like that, which some people did, but most people did. I never did. You had to build your own maps. You had to figure out your own way. You had to spend weeks and weeks and weeks, or months if you weren't playing every day, to finally solve a game. Yeah. And then later, with the Super Nintendo versions, you were expected to beat it, because they guide you through the game. You're not really expected to get lost, ever. The idea was, you will always know what to do. And, it's a different design philosophy, but I think it's visible in Super Nintendo games versus NES games. Yep. And maybe that's something, I'd love to make that a full topic discussion.
Yeah, sure.
Going forward.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Well, but do y'all agree kind of with that distinction? That
I do, actually. Yeah. To tie it back into a game we mentioned earlier, Red Dead Redemption. I think that actually there's a game called Gun, which came out right as Xbox and Xbox 360 it was a cross-platform in that sense. And it was one of those games where it handheld you through it, but it was a stronger story. It was a better, in many ways, better game if you're looking for a straight narrative. One of my favorite games is still continues to be Enslaved, Odyssey to the West, but it's a completely linear thing. There's minor RPG elements in it that you can figure out whether you want your big stick to glow when you hit the robot or to shoot out fireballs, but basically what it comes down to is you're going to be fighting this boss in this order and so on and so forth. So I don't ever want to say that linear stories are bad or that open-ended is better or anything like that. Sometimes I think that you need to understand what it is, the story that you're telling. And really it's about, are you shifting the storytelling to the player so that the player's experience becomes the story? Or are you telling the story, as the developer and there's a fixed story that you want to tell?
I think when we're talking about series like Legend of Zelda and Metroid, these are not series that people are playing for the story. Generally speaking, not for the developer story, at least.
Sure.
There's that lore background. There's that world that they're putting in there, and they're giving you some information about it. But I wouldn't call these narrative heavy games.
I think
that's the distinction that I'm talking about here when I'm talking about losing that sense of exploration versus the guidedness. There's a different experience that you're expecting when you're playing a game that you're playing for the narrative. I think we're just about ready to wrap up.
Yep.
Let's get going.
On that note, we'll go ahead and call this one a wrap. So thank you, everyone, for joining us for podcast number 30 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast.
Good night, everybody.
Peace.
Later.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us which games you think have the best lore and how you like to see it presented. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward compatible.